Consoles are going all digital, PlayStations are getting Xbox exclusives, and Windows 11 is getting the sudo command. Sounds to me like everyone wants to be just like the Steam Deck. It's time for another Deck News Roundup, and I've gotta say, it's a good one. First, not only are more and more developers targeting the Steam Deck specifically, but a recent major title release showcases how the Steam Deck is actually getting significant performance updates even 2 years after its initial release. At the same time, there is another big release that exposed a big mistake that some developers are still making. It's something that annoys basically all PC gamers to this day, and I think it's a mistake that devs should stop making in 2024, so I have a PSA for that. Finally, the Steam Deck has become such a phenomenon that people are now practically hallucinating handhelds out of thin air to compete with the Deck. I'm not kidding, it's true. So yeah, it's been an incredible week for Deck News, and hey, by the way, I don't have a sponsor for this video, and I don't know if you've noticed, but I've been getting closer and closer to that silver play button, so hook a brother up with a sub and let's get to this 100K. So Persona 3 Reload released to Steam, and by all accounts, this is easily the definitive way to play the game. Unlike last year's release of Persona 3 Portable, Reload is a full remake of the PS2 original. And while this means that it doesn't have some of the additions brought about from Persona 3 FES or Persona 3 Portable, it is such a well-executed modernization that it still manages to be far and away the best way to experience this game. The critical reception has been amazing, currently sitting at 89 on OpenCritic and an 88 on Metacritic, but the player reception on Steam has been phenomenal too, with over 97% of the user reviews on Steam being positive. As a result, this marks the second time in as many weeks that Sega has released a banger. First, Like a Dragon Infinite Wealth launched and then enjoyed over 45,000 concurrent players, and then just 1 week later they released Persona 3 Reload, which ends up managing the same feat. Suffice it to say, the people are loving Persona 3 Reload. The only irritation is the fact that performance on Steam Deck left a bit to be desired. Being a turn-based RPG, it was still more than playable, but it was nonetheless unexpected and for some, disappointing. SteamDeckHQ.com noted that there are spots that appear to bottleneck the GPU, but that there was nothing they could do to completely fix it, even turning down the render resolution of 50%. They also noted that unlocking the TDP didn't do anything, and the Persona 3 Reload never seemed to push the TDP anyway. Thankfully though, it didn't take folks too long to find out that the problem did in fact have an easy fix. It turns out, Persona 3 Reload has ray traced reflections, and you can easily fix the biggest performance issues by turning reflections off in the menu. By doing that, this Redditor's performance went from 25 FPS to 80+. To be clear, there were still areas that caused problems and some significant dips, but this helped a ton, and it makes sense that the Steam Deck will take a bigger hit with ray tracing anyway. But then, something else was discovered. By making some small modifications, you could force the Steam Deck to play this game using the latest version of Mesa, Mesa 24. In doing so, one problem area which was previously running on Deck at 23 FPS with terrible frame pacing was all of a sudden now running at 36 FPS with the silky smooth frame time. That is an over 50% improvement for ray tracing, but you can actually see a small performance bump even when ray tracing is disabled. The comments in the Reddit thread note that with reflections disabled, the frame rate went from 66 to 71. So yeah, somewhat modest return, but pretty good all things considered, and this is all thanks to, like I said, Mesa 24. Mesa 24 is the latest version of the Linux graphics driver Mesa, and it's something that Valve and open source contributors work diligently on improving. Taking a look at the announcement for Mesa 24, you can see that they highlight faster ray tracing performance and support for various new extensions. One other performance update that landed in the month of January, just in time to be included in version 24, is an improvement to a scheduler involved in shader processing. The net result is a smaller shader cache, but also some performance benefits, with one person seeing 4 to 14% higher frame rate for indoor scenes in Cyberpunk 2077. Finally, Valve saw everyone having performance issues with Persona 3 Reload and some people modding the Steam Deck to force Mesa 24, and Valve then incorporated the change themselves. They released SteamOS 3.5.14 in preview with these patch notes, specifically noting the improved performance of ray trace reflections in Persona 3 Reload as the top bullet point. You should note that there are still problem areas that don't reach the frame rates that they probably should, but this update does a lot of heavy lifting to make Persona 3 Reload a much more satisfying experience on Deck. I did see some people saying that this actually highlights a problem with the Steam Deck, implying that the Steam Deck needed to be updated in order to support Persona 3 Reload, thanks to SteamOS and Linux being behind the Windows ecosystem in terms of game compatibility, but I think that's a pretty severe mischaracterization of what actually happened here. In this case, the game compatibility for P3R already existed, and this update from Valve and open source contributors was a more recent version of the graphics drivers that bring performance updates that may or may not exist in Windows. Either way, it's good to see Valve continue to support their handheld machine so diligently 2 years after its release, and it is incredible that we're able to see this machine still have performance manage to be squeezed out of it. Another banger that was released to Steam last week, of course, was Tekken 8. This had some Valve fixes as well that I'll address, but there's also the matter of the PSA that developers need to hear. Tekken 8 did itself reach a peak of 49,000 players on Steam, and even now seems to hover around a daily peak of 35,000 concurrent players. Clearly, people are playing Tekken 8, and many are even playing on the Steam Deck. Digital Foundry covers the performance of Tekken 8 on the Steam Deck and provides some optimized settings. Overall, if you're just looking to play the fighting portion of the game, you can absolutely get a consistent 60 FPS, though your mileage may vary with the various modes available in T8. We even had a conversation about Tekken 8 on the Nerdnest podcast and how it feels like Tekken 8 is a true sequel to Tekken 3 that so many of us have been waiting for. And as an aside, I really have to say that with 2023 being as good as it was in terms of game releases, I honestly did not expect 2024 to kick off the way that it has. These first 5 weeks of game releases have been incredible and kind of uncanny to start a year off with games like Pal World, Enshrouded, Prince of Persia, Like a Dragon Infinite Wealth, Persona 3 Reload, and yes, Tekken 8. Let me know in the comments if you think 2024 is going to be able to compete with 2023, because right now it's looking like it will. Anyway, not everything was rosy for Tekken 8. It did launch with some connection issues that plagued the Steam Deck. It seems there was some sort of Proton issue that was causing multiplayer to fail on the deck. Thankfully, this was fixed by Valve pretty quickly, and then the game was fully playable online. The bigger problem is that Namco made a mistake that some developers are still making with the Steam Cloud. They made it so that the graphics settings are being stored in your cloud saves, which is a big no-no as far as I'm concerned with cloud saves. By doing this, it means your graphical settings are synchronizing across your different machines, and for many people with a Steam Deck, that's going to be a big problem. According to Overkill.wtf, about a third of Steam Deck owners also own a PC, and I've got to say there's almost no chance that you want to play with the same graphical settings on your PC as you do on your Steam Deck. Unfortunately, this means that every time you switch from playing Tekken on your PC to your Steam Deck or vice versa, you will have to adjust your graphical settings. Developers, please take this as a friendly PSA. Almost nobody wants this as a feature. Just check out this post from friend of the channel, Mosquito, with regard to Hi-Fi Rush, which launched with the same problem last year. Hi-Fi Rush not only synced video settings, but also audio settings. In his post, Mosquito detailed that on his desktop, he was playing 4K resolution with 5.1 surround sound. What kind of sense would it make to carry over those settings to a PC handheld with an 800p display and onboard speakers? Even Valve recommends against this in their official documentation. Their docs state that when developing for Steam Cloud support, developers should, quote, avoid machine-specific configurations such as video settings. When I was searching for any more information on this topic, I did find that someone scripted a workaround for this, and I haven't tested it myself, but the code does look pretty straightforward. It saves your preferred graphical settings locally and overwrites the cloud sync files with the locally stored files. Theoretically, this script could be modified to work with Tekken 8, but players really should not have to go this far. So come on, Namco, please fix this. So here's the thing, Deck Gang. I want to take a small break in between segments to tell you about one of my favorite things about the Steam Deck. People in gaming used to get excited about E3 because journalists would tell you all about some upcoming games, but Steam makes it so that now you can try upcoming games for yourself. That's right, it's my favorite time again. It's time for Steam Next Fest. Next Fest is an event put on by Valve every few months where hundreds of developers publish demos for games that should be coming out in the next 6 months or so. And there are always a ton of gems to play, so I want to rapid fire some recommendations to you. Let me know what you think. First up, is Berserk Boy. This game actually has a sentimental value to this channel. If you go back to the very first Steam Deck news video on my channel, the entire footage is basically just me playing the demo for this game, which I thought would be a perfect fit on the yet-to-be-released Steam Deck. So yeah, it's a 2D action platformer, a lot like Mega Man. Go give this one a shot, and if you like it, make sure to add it to your wishlist since that really helps out developers. Next up is Indica. My buddy Jimmy from Deck Ready mentioned this game to me, and it's what really pushed me to finally install and play some demos. Right off the bat, I can see why Jimmy enjoyed it. It's a really strange story-driven game where you play as a Russian nun that's on a journey and the devil is your travel companion. It's trippy and strange and well worth a try. Pepper Grinder is a game that I've been waiting months to play. It's an awesomely animated pixel art action platformer where your protagonist sports a drill kind of like Mr. Driller or Drill Dozer, but a lot more dynamic. You explore the world by grinding away at the earth around you with really fluid controls that help you master your own speed. It's a pleasure to play and it works great on deck. Spring Dash is a speed-running first-person shooter kind of like Neon White. You build up speed really fast in this game and there are alternate routes, so it seems like something that's going to be a lot of fun to make it to the top of the leaderboard in the full game. Ultros is another game I couldn't wait to get my hands on. It's a Metroidvania with gorgeous hand-drawn art. There are so many large-scale animations in this demo that just blew me away. The entire world is teeming with life, and it has great close-quarter combat that focuses on precision. This is my kind of jam. Crow Country is a survival horror in the vein of the PlayStation forebears, like the original Resident Evil games. Believe it or not, the developers of this game also made Snipperclips on the Nintendo Switch. In any case, this demo is a great interpretation and modernization of that retro-styled survival horror genre, and I can't wait for the final release later this year. So yeah, that is 6 really varied demos for you to try. Give them a shot, and if you like them, do not forget to wishlist. Alright, it's probably time to talk about the Steam Deck's Vaporware competition. That's not to say that the Steam Deck has no competition. Both the Lenovo Legion Go and the ROG Ally are really interesting devices that work especially well for people that want to play games like Destiny 2 or people that want more power than what the Steam Deck has. And then there are boutique manufacturers that are now increasing their focus on weird new designs like the Aya Neo Flip DS and the One X Player X1. But last week there was a new, alleged leak, this time revealing a PlayStation handheld that sounds like a device that would be more in competition with the Steam Deck than with the Nintendo Switch or the Switch's inevitable follow-up. There are quite a number of things that make the leak sound dubious to me, but on the other hand, the leak only alleges that Sony is in very early explorations, which, to be fair, is pretty easy to believe. I imagine that such a level of R&D is pretty common at any of the major hardware manufacturers. In any case, the source of this leak is the YouTuber Moore's Law is Dead, who regularly reports on all sorts of hardware leaks. He apparently got his information from one or more contacts he has at AMD. He also offered a lot of speculation as to what shape this handheld could take, but ultimately said that the only thing he can 100% confirm is that there is a handheld in very early development at AMD on behalf of Sony. That means that some of the details you may have heard about this device, like PS4 backwards compatibility and the potentiality of playing downclock PS5 games, was all speculation from Moore's Law is Dead. Personally, I would be very interested to see what shape a new PlayStation handheld could take and what sort of support Sony would throw at such a device, but even if it is real, it's a few years away, unlike the Orange Pi Neo, which now seems to be the closest thing to a Steam Deck alternative. Orange Pi are known for their single board computers, so, you know, alternatives to Raspberry Pi and such. But this time, they're working on a handheld they're calling the Neo. It's going to be using Manjaro Linux, which, like SteamOS, is based on Arch Linux. I've installed Manjaro on a PC handheld before, and I wouldn't call it handheld friendly, so I wonder if they're going to do any customizations to accommodate the form factor. Notably, this upcoming device sports dual trackpads just like the Steam Deck, so that should help. It's unclear if Steam itself will recognize the dual trackpads such that you can map them in Steam input or even use them to type in the virtual keyboard. Speaking of competition, the MSI Claw now has a page on the MSI store. You still can't order or anything like that, but it's notable that the page went up. We still don't have a firm release date either, but handheldhq.com is reporting that it appears to be launching on March 1st, at least in Thailand. That is courtesy of a translation of the Thai version of the store page. Oddly, MSI has gone back and forth on whether or not the Claw will have a variable refresh rate screen, but most recently, they confirmed to The Verge that it will in fact have a 48 to 120 Hz VRR display, so that is good news. The specs seem to match that of the ROG Ally, as far as we can tell. Finally, we are starting to get a little more information about the performance of the chipset in the Claw. In one of my recent hardware reviews, I covered the ONE X Player X1, which has the Intel Core Ultra 5 135H, the same chip that is in the $699 MSI Claw. Based on my benchmarks of that machine, I think Intel still has a ways to go in order to compete with AMD and the ROG Ally, and if you do want to know more, go watch my review of the ONE X Player X1. Finally, when it comes to competition, the Aya Neo Flip has gone up for pre-order. These are the Aya Neo clamshell handhelds that come in two important form factors, either the KB format, which sports a mini keyboard, or the more interesting DS format that comes equipped with a second screen, which should be perfect for 3DS emulation. Interestingly, these are also the first handhelds for sale with the brand new AMD 8840U. Let's close this out with some really cool Steam Deck related announcements. First of all, it has been confirmed that Skate will be coming to Steam. This could be a great companion to Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 1 and 2 on the Steam Deck. Unfortunately, what Steam giveth, Steam can also take away. And recently, Spec Ops The Line got delisted from the Steam store. That's quite unfortunate because it's a game that subverts the military shooter and it's something that should be preserved to be played. If you already own it, you can still play it, of course, and while it is labeled unsupported on the Steam Deck, you should be able to run it with no issues. Back to good news, the Metal Gear Solid collection has been updated so that more games are working on the Steam Deck specifically, and the upcoming Star Wars Dark Forces remaster has already been deck verified, which is more than I can say for the original. That remaster is coming courtesy of Night Dive Studios, one of my favorite studios in the biz. Sonic and Shadow Generations was announced during PlayStation State of Play and should be another great addition to the Steam Deck library. This remaster releases later this year and makes Shadow a playable character. Unsurprisingly, Pal World entered the top 20 most played games on Steam Deck for the month of January, and Enshrouded looks like it may be headed into the list for February. One thing I really, really love, by the way, are homebrew retro games, and Celeste 64 is, well, it's kind of that. Celeste 64 is a free 3D platformer created by the makers of Celeste in the vein of Nintendo 64 games. It's not made using N64 tech, and it doesn't run on N64 hardware, so it's not actually a homebrew game, but it certainly evokes that spirit, and it plays well on the Steam Deck. You should be able to use something like non-Steam launchers to install itch.io, and then install this game on your Steam Deck. Give it a shot. Alright, that's gonna do it for this week's Deck News Roundup. I've been dropping a ton of handheld reviews, so check those out if you're interested. I hope you're having a wonderful week. Deck Gang out. Goodbye!